The following teaching is possible thanks to the friends and partners of Spirit and Truth Fellowship International.
You know, I love teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ, and I love teaching about what he's doing today. And it's such a wonderful relationship between God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and his son, Jesus Christ, to whom he's given all authority. And because God so loved the world that he gave, and for all the things that God has done, we worship and honor and bless and praise him. And because Jesus Christ so loved us that he gave his own life for us, that we honor and bless and praise Jesus Christ. And as I said, it's this wonderful balance of relationship where in our heart of hearts, we keep God separate for being God, the Father, the Creator, the one who thought all this up, and yet fully honor Jesus Christ for everything he's done, all that he deserves, and frankly, all that God has given him to be, which is, we're going to see, is a lot. And I'll tell you, Jesus Christ is busy. He is busy because he is coordinating so many things all over the planet and doing so many things. So let's just take some time here and see what Jesus Christ is doing. The first thing we want to recognize, and clearly recognize from Scripture and see, is that Jesus Christ is second in command to God. This is very clear. After Jesus was raised from the dead, the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 18, Jesus comes to his disciples and says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." And here, even in that, we see this delicate balance between God the Father and the Son, and how the Son has all authority, but that he's been given that authority by the Father. And so then Ephesians chapter 1 tells us more about this authority with Christ. And in verse 18, he starts out in a prayer and he says that you may know. So he wants us to know some things. He starts out with a hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power. And then the scripture says that power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. Now we'll see this right hand thing come up several times. And even today, we use the phrase right hand man. God surely has made Christ his right hand man. And God works through Christ, just like a king works through his second in command, his right-hand man. And then it says in verse 21 that God exalted him far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every title that can be given, not only in this present age, but also in the world to come. Nobody's ever going to be higher than Jesus. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body. And so God did indeed exalt Christ to be second in command. Now, when we think about the scripture, is there a picture? Is there a portrayal? Is there some kind of foreshadowing in the Old Testament that God was going to do this for Christ? Absolutely there is. Absolutely. Do you remember the record of Joseph and Pharaoh and how Joseph was in Pharaoh's prison and then he was elevated to being Pharaoh's second in command? And here's what Pharaoh says in Genesis chapter 41, verse 44. Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh." And you can just see God raising Christ from the dead and saying, "I am God." But then Pharaoh goes on, he says, "But without your word, no one will lift hand or foot in Egypt." And that's a beautiful foreshadowing, a beautiful portrayal of what God did for Jesus Christ. That he raised him up from this earthly body, gave him a new spiritual body, made him second in command, and gave him all authority on heaven and earth. Wow, that's pretty cool. And we see this this right-hand man thing play out then through other places of Scripture. Stephen was the first martyr of the Christian church, killed by a mob of Jews in Acts chapter 7. And God did a wonderful thing for Stephen as Stephen was about to die. And frankly, not only a wonderful thing for Stephen, but for us too, who get to be inspired by the vision that Stephen saw. Because as he was dying, look, he said, Acts 7:56, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Now, what did Stephen see? I mean, if we thought about it, what does he mean? Sees the heaven open and the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, standing at the right hand of God. What are we talking about there? God gave Stephen the same revelation picture of himself that he gave Moses in Exodus chapter 24, that he gave Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6, that he gave Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 1, that he gave John in the opening chapters of Revelation, that there was this great throne in heaven and God is sitting on it. And so now the heavens peel back for Stephen and here's that great throne. And if it was like Moses saw, you know, the stonework underneath it was sapphire, beautiful, beautiful colors like that of a rainbow all around it, according to Ezekiel in the book of Revelation, and then sitting on the throne is God, and then standing there in the position of power at God's right hand is Jesus Christ. What a fabulous picture. No wonder we honor Christ. No wonder we praise Christ. God has so ordained it. God has set it up that way. Absolutely. And again, this wonderful balance between in our hearts honoring God as the creator of the heavens and the earth, and honoring Christ for being the one that so loved me, so loved you, that he gave his life, and not just died. Lots of people can just die for you. But he lived every minute of his life without sin so that he would be the perfect sacrifice. You know, there are days that I think I probably make it from the time I wake up till the time I go to bed without sinning. There are some days like that. But I'll tell you what, we get caught up in our flesh and we get weak moments. And you know, Jesus Christ, he just fought through those. And he just so focused on loving you and me that he gave up his life as the sinless sacrifice. No wonder we honor and praise him. No wonder God has said, this is the man I want to be my right-hand man, sure. And now the Bible says that Jesus is Lord. Now, Lord is a word we don't use a lot. And in the Western world, we don't anymore have much of lords and ladies and all that kind of authority structure and hierarchy. So what does Lord mean? When the Bible talks about Lord, what does it mean? Well, I just grabbed an English dictionary and looked it up. Lord is one having power and authority over others. Well, I'd say that fits Jesus. He has power and authority today because God gave it to him. And by the way, a kind of a just offhand definition of Lord would be boss, that Jesus is the boss. Absolutely. And so what does the Bible say that very clearly? Sure. The Apostle Peter, first sermon to a bunch of Jews on the day of Pentecost in the temple. And he says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus who you crucified, both Lord and Christ. You see, God made Jesus Lord, and now he's Lord. So he deserves to be treated like the Lord. By the way, how do you and I get saved? How do we go from being natural people who we're going to live 40, 60, 80 years, and then we're going to be dead, to having everlasting life, literally. We're going to live forever. How does that happen? Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God. He lived a sinless life to make that available. And now how do we receive it? Romans 10:9 says it very plainly, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Well, is it hard to believe that somebody that lived like Jesus, that God would make him Lord? That's not hard. If you haven't said that, I invite you, please, don't miss out on living forever. Confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord. It's as easy as saying, Jesus, I confess you as my Lord. That's as simple as it is. And you believe it in your heart. Oh, you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead. You know, for a while I used to think that'd be difficult. Come on. God created the heavens and earth out of nothing. I think he can raise a dead guy. It's pretty easy for him to do. You want Jesus Christ to be your Lord? You want to live forever? Confess Christ as Lord. Believe God raised him from the dead. God gives birth inside of you with Holy Spirit. Actually, Jesus is the one who does it. We'll see that in coming up. Jesus gives birth to you with Holy Spirit. You become born again. You become added to the church, and you have everlasting life. So let's maintain that delicate balance. We know God is God, and we honor him, and Jesus is Lord, and we honor him. God bless you.